Oh, hi everyone, beautiful people out there. Thank you so much for joining us for the second second event in a four-event series, excuse me, co-presented by Booksmith and the Clarion Alley Mural Project. My name is Evan Karp. I'm the events manager for Booksmith. We're an independent bookstore and mainstay of San Francisco's Haight-Ashbury district since 1976. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the store and what we have going on, and then I'm going to turn it over to Camp's Christopher Statton, who will be our MC for the evening. Thank you again all so much for being here for this wonderful project. A little bit about the store: Booksmith centers stories of the marginalized and underrepresented to create what we hope is an equitable place for everybody. Our store is open for curbside pickup from 11 to 6 every day. You can also shop online at booksmith.com and we will deliver right to your door. We're currently offering free shipping throughout San Francisco and the East Bay area. We have a bunch of great events coming up, all virtual, of course. On Thursday the 4th, we're very proud to host the launch event for local writer Louisa Flynn Goodlett's debut poetry collection, Look Alive. There'll be readings by Louisa, of course, also Kaming Chang, Alicia Mountain, Arm Choi Wild, and Meg Day. That it promises to be spectacular. I hope you can join us for that. That's this coming Thursday. Also around the corner, we have events with Arisa White. So excited to host her for Who's Your Daddy. We also have events with Naima Koster, with Carolina DeRobertis for What's Mine and Yours, Naima's new book. And then we will have Jeff Chang and David D. Cook here for the YA edition of Can't Stop, Won't Stop, which is just coming out next month. You can find out more about those events and a lot more at booksmith.com. Before I introduce Christopher, I just want to go over a few house items. At the top right corner of your screen, you'll see the chat, which you've probably seen already. I encourage you to show the artist love there. Let us know where you're tuning in from if you'd like. And please ask questions anytime if you have questions for any of the authors, for the artists, for the curators at any point. We will have a Q&A at the end of the program. I ask that if you have a question, though, to just be specific about who you're asking it for, so we can make sure to direct it correctly. We have a one-strike policy in the chat, anything even remotely trolly or hateful, and we will be forced to remove you. Please don't do that to us or to yourself. Beneath the chat there, you'll notice that we have a place where you can make donations to Booksmith if you'd like to support the store. Each of our virtual events costs about $100 to produce. So if you have a few spare bucks and you'd like to help us keep our programming going, we would appreciate it very much. We've hosted more than 120 events since first shutting down in March, and we hope to keep it going strong. Also, I should say, if you're having any trouble with the chat or any technical difficulties, hang tight and I will be right over in just a moment. But before I am, it's my honor to introduce Christopher Statton. He's the co-director of Clarion Alley Mural Project. Christopher is an artist, arts administrator, and community activist based in San Francisco. Prior to CAMP, Statton was executive director of San Francisco's Roxy Theater during its transition to a nonprofit, community-based independent film venue. Statton became involved with CAMP in 2012 when the Roxy Theater hosted projects and events celebrating CAMP's 20th anniversary. Since then, Statton has collaborated or individually painted seven murals on Clarion Alley and three murals in Yogyakarta, Indonesia, as part of the Jenning Street Art Project and Bangkit Arise, an international exchange project, which Statton also helped to organize. In 2013, he was the recipient of the San Francisco Film Critics Circle's Marlon Riggs Award for Courage and Vision in the Bay Area Film Community and received the San Francisco's Board of Supervisors Certificate of Honor. An alumnus of the Said Business School's Postgraduate Organizational Leadership Program at Oxford University, Statton is currently a member of the Leaderless San Francisco Poster Syndicate. That's it for me. Thank you all so much for being here tonight. This is such a great project, and I just want to say thank you to Megan and to Ma, who you'll hear more from shortly, for organizing it and for bringing us all together. Christopher, very pleased to turn it over to you. Thanks for emceeing tonight.
Thank you, Evan. And thank you to our hosts, the Booksmith and the Bindery, for making this virtual event possible. Good evening. Welcome everyone to the second of four public events as part of Clarion Alley Mural Project's Wall in Response, where poets are invited to write in response to murals on Clarion Alley. Thank you for taking the time on your Friday night to join us here. I hope everyone is doing well and staying healthy. As our nation passes a tragic milestone of 500,000 deaths due to COVID, I'm grateful for the strong community in which we belong and for all those who are volunteering to support people in need. And though only virtually, I'm grateful to be able to gather online and share this powerful evening with you here tonight. While 500,000 deaths are shocking, when a closer look is taken at the data, an even more shocking story is told. Black and Latinx Americans are more likely to be hospitalized and die from the coronavirus, while white Americans are getting vaccinated more. This kind of excess mortality is representing structural inequities that have existed for a long time. This story is repeated with sickle cell disease. A recent report by the American Society of Hematology found immense suffering in the sickle cell community due to inadequate access to medical care. This is where I first was introduced to the Black Panthers and Emory Douglas's work. I was born with hemophilia, and growing up in the Bay Area, I was a patient of Oakland Children's Hospital's hematology clinic. I spent my childhood with other hematology patients, some who were going to the Black Panther sickle cell clinic. From as far back as I can remember, I knew having a community supporting a clinic was unique and special. But the more I thought about it, the more it made sense. Instead of seeing one person's name or one family's name on a clinic, seeing a whole community standing behind those seeking support was empowering. And at that age, I had no concept of the tragic history that brought about this grassroots community support. Sitting there waiting for the doctor, I heard about the 1972 update to the Black Panthers 10-point plan, demanding free healthcare access for all Black and oppressed people. I didn't understand the violence of capitalism, but I began to understand its consequences. I learned that the FBI shut down neighborhood clinics that were opened by the Panthers, deliberately smashing medical equipment during raids to ensure the clinics would remain closed. And I knew that I was alive because I had access to that care that others were denied. So I'm very humbled to be here tonight on the virtual stage with superheroes such as Emory Douglas, people who created so much power by empowering people to be the heroes that they truly are. The ability to speak a universal language to people who aren't opposed to their governments, just opposed to anything that denies them of their human right to dignity and respect. This is the universal language which advertisers strive for but never will achieve because their work wants something from the viewer. Emory's work wants to give something to the viewer: power, justice, respect, dignity, and superheroes. The images by Emory welcome all struggles, tragedies, and triumphs because they strip away the false narratives of those in power and help us see the world as it is, to help us imagine the world as it could be, to know as individuals each of us are capable of amazing things, and together the power of the people cannot be stopped. Together, it was a group of artists who painted this remix of Emory's work: CUBA, Dave Petrelli, and MACE. And it's these artists who keep the murals fresh and updated with messages. And it's because of them, when people walk down the alley, there's always new additions for discussion and education. And that's what the alley really has to offer. Not only colorful murals, but a tapestry of stories from the community woven together in one space, a place where we can see our collected story. I was excited when CAMP's co-director Megan Wilson and poet Maw Shein Win came together for a collaboration and created Wall in Response. This would be a new way for messages of the community to keep expanding and reaching new audiences. And at the conclusion of Wall in Response, Sun Night Editions will be printing a limited series portfolio of the poems with the images. These poems, aligned with these murals, will create new points of entry for discussion, education, and empowerment. Megan Wilson is a visual artist, writer, and activist based in San Francisco. Wilson has been a co-organizer of Clarion Alley Mural Project since 2001. Maw Shein Win is a poet, educator, and editor who lives and teaches here in the Bay Area. Win is the first poet laureate of El Cerrito, California, and her recent poetry collection, Storage Unit for the Spirit House, was published by Omnidon in October of 2020. Tonight's Wall in Response event will include a video of each poet reading on Clarion Alley in front of the mural, What We Want, filmed and edited by Mahima Kotian, and it will run about 30 minutes. The film will open with Megan introducing the project, followed by Ma introducing each poet, Kim Shuck, Jennifer Hasegawa, Karla Brundage, and Tureeda Mikell. Lastly, Emory will speak about the mural in his work. And we're very thankful to Equipto for providing music in the film. Immediately following the film, we're honored to be joined by the curators, muralists, and poets for a Q&A. Please type your questions into the chat at any time during the film or Q&A, and we will try to get to all of them. Though we are physically in separate spaces, let us celebrate our ability to gather together tonight and listen to the words of these powerful poets take us on a journey together down Clarion Alley. Thank you. Evan, you can start the film.
Hi everyone, I'm Megan Wilson, artist and organizer with Clarion Alley Mural Project. Welcome to Wall in Response, a project featuring 16 poets responding to the social, political, and racial justice narratives of four murals on Clarion Alley, co-curated by myself and poet Maw Shein Win. Participants include poets Heather Barbeau, Eileen Casanetto, Tongo Eisen Martin, and Chris Straffolino responding to the mural Justice for Luis D. Gongora Pat by Marina Perez Wong and Elaine Chu, working with the Gongora Pat family and justiceforluis.org. Poets Karla Brundage, Jennifer Hasegawa, Tureeda Mikell, and Kim Shuck responding to the work What We Want by Emory Douglas, remixed by David Petrelli, CUBA, and MACE. Poets Celeste Chan, M.K. Chavez, Paul Corman Roberts, and Tim Zonnelly responding to the mural Affordable Housing, Vivienda Asequible, by the SF Print Collective, working with the Western Regional Advocacy Project, RAP, and poets Youssef Alawi, Jason Bayani, Jenny Lim, and Michael War, responding to the Arab Liberation Mural by Art Forces, the Arab Resource Organizing Center, AROC, and Arab Youth Organizing, AYO. Wall in Response is made possible with the generous support of the San Francisco Arts Commission and the Zellerbach Family Foundation. Thank you for believing in our work. Selecting the murals for Wall in Response, I reflected on Clarion Alley Mural Project's role in the community over the past decade in response to the hyper-gentrification that has plagued the San Francisco Bay Area. The cultural shift has meant an epidemic of evictions, a significant decrease in our Black and Latinx communities, devastating income inequality, an overwhelming number of people who are unhoused, and a disturbing increase in police violence and fatal shootings of citizens by police. In response to these impacts of hyper-gentrification in the Bay Area and throughout the world, CAMP made the decision to prioritize projects that give voice to local and global narratives in support of social, economic, political, racial, and environmental justice. The four murals selected for Wall in Response exemplify successful collaborations between artists and larger organizing forces that represent this collective effort. Based on the walls selected, my co-curator, Maw Shein Win, invited Bay Area poets whose practices include social and political engagement to respond to the power of resistance reflected in these works. Thank you for joining us. Stay safe. What We Want reflects the legacy of the Black Panthers and their core work towards social, political, racial, economic, and food justice. The mural, painted in 2011 and based on a design by artist Emory Douglas with elements from the Black Panther Party's 10-point program, is a remix by Douglas with David Petrelli, CUBA, and MACE. The artists periodically add messaging based on critical needs of the moment. These gestures of care and thoughtfulness reflect the intent of the original work and support the ongoing movement to secure the demands stated in What We Want Now.
Bay Area poets, Karla Brundage, Jennifer Hasegawa, Tureeda Mikell, and Kim Shuck read poems in response to the mural, We Want Respect, Freedom, Land, Housing, Justice, Peace, Bread, by Emory Douglas, remix by David Petrelli, MACE. Their practice and work speak to social and political community engagement, and their poems honor the message of this powerful mural. Kim Shuck is a solo author of 7 collections of poetry. Fog Gazer, collector of odd ends, and dreamer, Shuck was born in the 60s in San Francisco. Kim is the 7th poet laureate of that city. In 2019, Shuck was awarded a National Laureate Fellowship by the Academy of American Poets and a Censorship Award from Penn Oakland. Kim's latest published work is a single poem chapbook, Who's Water, from Mammoth Publications. Shuck is a citizen of the Cherokee Nation of Oklahoma. In her poem, I will take my paycheck in indigenous people who die of old age in bed, she writes. Because we are measured in teeth, removed before our skulls are returned, stolen as they were from our graves.
I will take my paycheck in indigenous people who die of old age in bed. The supplies they sent were body bags, because we're measured in scars, in trauma, incurable but no less deadly disease, because we're measured by the inmate, the vanished, the couldn't afford school, because we're measured in teeth, removed before our skulls were returned, stolen as they were from our graves, cracked by grinding in sleep, in stress, because the commodity can said fish, but was full of tails and bones, and there is no running water. Because in order to read a book about a city Indian who isn't an addict, who isn't beaten by a boyfriend, who doesn't die in the first chapter, I had to write it my own self. The price of my work has changed. I also remember Annie Mae. Your name has shapeshifted, I've watched it, can't pronounce you anymore. Hero, relative, self, dreaming during the storm, I'm sorting beads, threading the needle, waxing the thread. Can glass and hide be made to explain slow human sacrifice? A ballistics report, thumbed and read and memorized and folded and sewn into the soles of my dance shoes. Because this story is mine too, things not allowed in court, rumor, a hard wind, a ballistics report, slow sacrifice. People can die of disappointment, yes. She could have been my cousin, myself. She could have been my sister, then my daughter, and eventually, she could have been a grandchild, a descendant. I could be her ancestor. I could have watched her die and in war, and it is still war, yes. Complete with standoff and trophies. Who will wear Annie's bracelets on wrists lifted in the morning red? Will this storm be over by then? Will we all still be serving a life sentence? For Norma Jean Croy. When Norma Jean was in prison, witness to a thing declared not to have happened, accomplice to nothing and shot in the back. The ceremonies continued, and sacred caves were subject to gradual water. I've been seduced by water even when it slides palms over a place I would otherwise stand in, a place I have stood in, wearing sandals, water to my knees, and prayed small child thoughts into the listening ears of water. Sank a small hand, like Sirius, into the silt, to find the next unfired shell. I let that bullet rest there between life and heart and fate lines and stared at such an expensive thing returned to water that licks the leftover caves of lead mines, metal finding its level. And later, after Norma Jean's lovers have run similar hands over the scar just there on my own back, luckily placed where there was no threat to spine or lung. If their hands were clever, they found it there, brass unstamped, and some have left it, and some have temporarily pulled it from my flesh in curiosity. But there's no way to explain what we hold on to, no way to explain how we carry our fears. September 2020. You would have been 27 on the equinox. I'm mother to an ancestor. Still carry your library card. When just an armful, I'd wrap you in a blanket next to my floor loom. You sang before you spoke in rhythms of weaving. Sang in wild southeastern twills. Funny girl, that city ate you in large bites. In court to get a restraining order, an awkward mouthful of words I never heard you sing. Your camera came back broken. Your ashes, urn in horrible pink and purple, I glued a handlebar mustache just there, halfway between the base and lid. You would have loved that, and you would have hated this poem. Thank you.
Jennifer Hasegawa is a Pushcart Prize nominated poet who has sold funeral insurance door to door. She was born and raised in Hilo, Hawaii, and lives in San Francisco. The manuscript for her first book of poetry, La Chica's Field Guide to Bonsai Living, won the Joseph Henry Jackson Literary Award. Her work has appeared in the Adroit Journal, Bamboo Ridge, Thule Review, and Vallum, and is forthcoming in Bennington Review and Jubilat. In her poem, The Universal Panther, she opens with these lines. Gather ghost rosettes and place them on your body to make it invisible, to make the me into the we.
The Universal Panther. Gather ghost rosettes and place them on your body to make it invisible, to make the me into the we. Now you can see what is hidden, cages built quietly, annual rings we can't see until we cut ourselves open like trees. Taste your rings. Store them for her in the tops of acacias so that when you hunger, she can fill her milky vaults of tenderness. She will be your auntie, and you will be hers. She doesn't need proof of blood to love. She is the door that opens. She is the universal panther, laying her endless body across the void, seven glorious teats pumping, defiant, and ready to feed. For the first time, the sadness is stronger than the past. Imagine them fist fighting in the dark, and what is the color of the blood of joy. What a wonder to cross the gleaming ghost line, to wander where the street sweepers are now the weeping, bent over gutters. Protein alleyways yield comfort no more, losing grip on the shore, but keep pulling, pulling. Is this how you know you've lived? When you can see slow motion unspooling? The wrong too strong. Scrubbed till fingers bled, too foul to get clean in this life. This is how it is now. But don't we stop washing, mending what is on fire? In the milky eyes of heroes, through lids shutting like sunsets, a flash so focused that if you've seen it, you know what it is to be punched in the face by a god. See how they stride. See how they strive. See how they stillness lie down in caskets to let us walk across for as long as it takes to get clean over to the other side. And I'll close with this poem called The Spring of What We Want. When was the last time someone asked us, what do you want? The world is struggling with so many of us not having what we want, just to keep the light on. So ask yourself now, don't tuck your lips in your pocket. Don't shut your mouth like a drawer. This life is not your final dollar. Each time my father got laid off, my mother would start hoarding toilet paper, as if these rolls could feed us more deeply than her love. So say it. We want stone of justice, iron of land, fire of housing, water of respect, air of bread, light of freedom, stoop of peace, where we can all sit amongst wolves and lambs and lions and mice, marveling at the sameness of our hearts, turning blood-stained fields into a drop of milk from which everything we want will spring.
Karla Brundage is a Bay Area-based poet, activist, and educator. Born in Berkeley, California in the summer of love to a Black mother and white father, Karla spent most of her childhood in Hawaii, where she developed a love of nature. She is a Pushcart Prize nominee and the founder of West Oakland to West Africa Poetry Exchange, and is a board member of the Before Columbus Foundation. Her poetry, short stories, and essays have been widely anthologized and can be found in Sparkle and Blink, Lockjaw, Nervous Ghost Press, Bamboo Ridge Press, Vibe, and Conch. Her most recent project is co-editing a collection called Colossus Home, which features poets from the Bay Area in solidarity with Moms for Housing and advocating for housing justice. She writes in Conjuring Justice. She wears healing green, land of Africa. He wears red, blood of Black people. We carry our self-determination in our back pockets.
We demand an immediate end to police brutality and the murder of Black people. Huey Newton. Black woman's hands, washed wounds, sift blood, shape justice. Black man's hands, snap magic, shape dragons, our power. Panthers pounce and strike, carry demands, conjure equality. We bear arms to be seen, not only as equal and free, not only as powerful and Black, but as vulnerable and delicate, as ever-changing and evolving, as capable and visionary. We are destined to expand not only out of poverty, but into prosperity and land ownership, small business loans and equal lending. Full employment does not mean being on the front line. It means health care, ujama, cooperative economics. She wears healing green, land of Africa. He wears red, blood of Black people. We carry our self-determination in our back pockets. This poem was inspired by reflecting on Black women in political power. She dreams of a 10-point plan. 1, the brutal killing of Black people must stop. Children, 2, are not meant to be hungry. Give them lunch and freedom. 3, schools that teach self-determination and community. 4, employment is a right, not jails. Close them and stop police. 5, wars of aggression that support unjust laws in this land. 6, we need bread, education, just, peace, control of news. 7, technology should be made healthcare completely free to we. 8, demand prison reform to so-called crimes under just laws. 9, to carry arms to protect ourselves and power to determine. 10, our destiny is not robbery by capitalists, but unity. This final poem was inspired by Angela Davis and is dedicated to her. Angela, I was a hippie child when Angela Davis strode tall in glittering golden alongside Stokely Carmichael. I can only remember there was a lobby, a beautiful tiny book, I a Virgo, she in Age of Aquarius, pictures of miniature Renaissance castles, peasants working in fields, a 10-point plan. We want decent housing. Angela spent what seems in my memory a long time with me that night. She told me many secrets about equality and decent education and ending police brutality through astrological signs and fairy tales. I fell in love with her that night. She signed my book, which I still have. Later, I grew up and studied about her in college. Read her books when I became conscious of myself as a Black woman in America. In my early 20s, I had a chance to see her speak at an Oakland event. I was so excited. I rushed backstage to meet her. I wanted to remind her of that quiet night in Honolulu in the 1970s. But when the moment came, my words were lost. Thank you.
Tureeda Mikell, Tureeda, is a story medicine woman, an activist for holism, called a word magician, and an award-winning poet published internationally. Qigong healer, workshop leader, storyteller, lyricist, performance artist, founder of the Tree of Life Foundation, HLP. She teaches children, youth, and adults to find their voice. She was a featured storyteller for the 50-year anniversary of the Black Panther Party, National Association of Black Storytellers, and Poet Storyteller celebrating Octavia Butler's 70th birthday. Tureeda's latest publications are Synchronicity, The Oracle of Sun Medicine, and Patrice Lumumba Anthology, both published by Nomadic Press. In her poem Justice, she intones, raise fist, what's the call? Free 'em all, what's the call? Free 'em all. Free all Black, red, brown, political prisoners. Free them all.
Raise fist, what's the call? Free 'em all, what's the call? Free 'em all. Free all Black, red, brown, political prisoners. Free them all. I fought in Nam, my pops in World War II. U.S. military used our bodies as shields on the front lines of war. Come home to find we're still dissed and dismissed. Oh, hell no. We got PTSD from this shit. Police need to ease up off our neck. Stop the killing spree. Respect. Like the BS Bible suggests, do unto others as you would have them do unto who? You. You heard me. Don't act like you didn't hear me. Is the church lying? We want access to housing, land, bread, and a living wage. And justice. Tell them, sister, I got your back. Panther's 10-point program demands that. Don't let my bright eye popping fits fool you, sis. I hear you. Jailing our minds and one nation under whose sky, chief? America incarcerates more Blacks today than was enslaved in 1850. You got that right. Like Alexander said, got children everywhere witnessing moral decay in land of the free at the cost of somebody's brave KKK killing survivor institutionalized lynchings. Ripped us out of Africa, not one native tongue returned. Psycho-emotional burns, baby. You hear me? We ain't begging for nothing, just asking for fair proceeds to land deed, slave wage, back pay owed. Reparations is all it is, my brother, reparations. Yeah, right again, sis. Respect. The same respect they give themselves. What's the call? Free them all. What's the call? Free them all with liberty and justice for all. Life light remembered. We are soldiers on the battlefield with life light in our eyes, said Sister Sonia. 1994, 23 years after volunteering at the George Jackson Free Health Clinic, the Tribune calls, asks, how many guns did you have at the Black Panther Clinic? How many guns? Not how many services were provided? Not how many programs were implemented? Not how many doctors or healthcare workers volunteered? Not even why we'd care to put into practice such a program with so many hospitals in our community? No, didn't ask any of that. Wanted to know how many guns we had. Not what illnesses or diseases most affected our communities, or how often we screened for diabetes, sickle cell, or checked for high blood pressure, if at all, or what may have been my specialty at the time. I would have told them of certain grains to regain genetic memory, but they were more interested in how many guns we had, not who ran the clinic, or what hours or days of the week we were open, or who was our hero or shero to set about such a task that sustains our health needs today? No, the reporter didn't ask any of that. They wanted to know how many guns we had. Black men and women, late teens, 20-somethings, volunteered to become doctors, nurses, pharmacists, therapists, completed homework between seeing patients. Black volunteer staff physicians, Dr. Talbert Smalls and Eddie Newsom developed methadone programs to destroy heroin dependence, reverse curse of opioid addictions, purposely placed in our neighborhoods to weaken the Black power base. We took vital signs, provided prenatal care, kept patient records, organized charts, med rooms, pharmacy, gave better care than Kaiser dared, held life light in our eyes. Books are bullets, educationally armed our right to fight through walls that imprisoned us as violent, drug-infested, gun-carrying, sex-crazed jigaboos. Kwame Ture warned, education in this country makes you stupid, but what is worse, it makes you arrogant in your stupidity. The revolution is coming whether you want it or not. It is coming whether you want it or not. The revolution will not be televised. The revolution will be live. How many guns did we have? We were soldiers on the battlefield with life light in our eyes. We are soldiers on the battlefield with life light in our eyes. At a restaurant in Oakland, boy toddler toasted tone holds soft brown eyes that stare. I don't recognize him, but he seems to recognize me and in some way feels strangely familiar. Placed in restaurant high chair, he turns around every chance he gets to look at me and smile. Getting ready to leave, I walk toward his mother and ask, your child is so charming. He looks oddly familiar and keeps looking at me as though he knows me. Do we know one another? I don't know, she says, but my mother you may know. Her name is Diana. Oh my, that's your mother? Of course I do, but I haven't seen her in years and didn't know you had a baby. As her son continues to look with eyes that smile so old, letting me know, babies are rooted souls always watching us come and go from the other side. So take heed. The impact of our decisions must be made on the next seven generations, those faces yet still beneath the ground. Law of the Seven Great Nations. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Emory Douglas. I'm an artist, do a lot of social justice political artwork from the 1960s up until now to present. And this mural that's behind me was encouraged and suggested by CUBA, a long-gone graffiti artist, along with David Petrelli. I wanted to use one of my images on the wall. And from there, it took on a life of its own. Many folks have been involved in the creation of it, the ongoing process of developing and enhancing it as it is today. It was not a me art, but a we art. And it's a continuum, very generic in many ways. It has stood the challenges of sampling or marking on it, I guess because of the collective grassroots connection to the mural itself in that way. And so it continues to be an amazing journey of the art itself. For myself, I do a lot of still do a lot of political graphics and social justice work myself. And traveling when we weren't in lockdown, you can say lockdown, traveling. And so I do a lot of work now, integrated into computer at the age of 77, almost a couple of weeks from 78, a couple of months from 78. I don't get up on, stretch up and get up and do much painting on the walls anymore, but I do is work with the other artists and young artists who want to sample the work or contribute and integrate it into some of the things I've done into their mural work or artwork themselves. Yeah. Like a slow bullet, like a slow bullet. I'm not ready to die, but not afraid.
The distinguishing the differences and what my mission is. So when I speak it, it's definitive. Situation haywire. There ain't no wonder why I stay high. Every day's like I may die. Things I wanna make right when I took advantage of my privilege. Now, ready for the role I play in the village amongst our community to act with some urgency. It hurts, but it's part of the plan of what our purpose is. Frontliners, they contribute in their own way.
All right. Thank you. Thank you to all the poets. And that was awesome. I loved being able to meet you guys in the alley, pandemic notwithstanding, and to gather for these readings. And I wanted to just kick off the Q&A. I guess I should pause first and say, if you are holding on to a question, drop it in the chat and we will pass it along to the authors. If you want to ask someone specific or if you want to pose a question to all the authors, please just specify who it's for. I have a question which is for any or all of you authors, which is what was it like responding to the mural? What was the process like, maybe for you? And also, was it in league with the work that you do? Or did it feel different making it at this time?
I can have a great memory of us having a chance to talk with Emory and David about their inspiration for the original imagery and inspiration for the mural. And that's what really drove the direction I took
took my poems, and I felt really privileged to have a chance to talk with them.
For me, it was quite reflective of the message of the mural, like being brought into a community of artists to talk about social justice. So I was super excited about that. And then I was really influenced by the colors of the mural, you know, the red and the black and the green and the gold, as well as the words from the 10-point plan. So I was really, it took me back to my childhood, which was a place that I hadn't really gone in my poetry for a while. So it was really beautiful. So I was grateful.
Yeah, I was taken just going back to the memories of that time, and you know, there was artwork that we would see of Emory all over the place because that was his weapon, to set about the art of the people and what we were going through and what was being said and what needed to be done. And so I was just really honored to be asked to be involved with this project and with all the poets here. I've worked with many of you over the years. And so I'm just very, very thankful to be here and be able to share my part and contribute my piece. Thank you.
I think the thing that struck me the most about the conversation that we got to have with one another and with Emory about inspirations and all of that was that the idea that our work might be in dialogue with the mural. And so I sort of wrote in tandem with it, you know, and not what frequently ends up happening in any sort of list of oppressed or underrepresented communities is that my Native people, Indigenous people tend to get left off the list because if we're present, you don't see us and all of that. So I wrote about two, in addition to the piece that I wrote specifically for the project, I also wrote two pieces, one about Annie Mae Aquash, who was a victim of the COINTELPRO project against the AIM. When I was a young person, and then Norma Jean Croy, who was a political prisoner of California Native heritage, and just sort of to speak in tandem that our experiences are so, they're very different and they're very close at the same time. And I had a moment of real pain, I guess, when I read the just that whole idea that there could be needs met somehow, particularly right now, particularly right after some of the stuff that has happened on reservations with the COVID stuff. And it just, it pulled the thing out of me or two, you know. Anyway, thank you for asking. I'm babbling now, but thank you for asking.
Oh, that's why I mentioned at the beginning, the red. You know, yeah, the black, red, and brown, because we knew from, if it wasn't about, we knew that it was going to be a trickle down effect. It hits us, it's going to hit everybody, just like the opioid addiction that's taking place. We saw that coming years ago because they brought it to us. And then now it's everywhere. So, yeah. Mentioning the red, the brown, the black. Yeah, it's.
You always do it. You always do. And we know we're probably cousins, you and I.
No doubt, no doubt.
Thank you all. I think in the same way that, or in a similar way that you all have looked up to, you know, for instance, Emory and the Black Panthers specifically, mm-hmm. you know, and in the way that you're saying that it was a trickle down effect, Tureeda, I could say that I feel the same way about you poets in some ways, and I know that both in this room and in the other rooms that you go, you know, you're sharing your own murals, if you will, mm-hmm. and your own messages that people will take with them, and I just want to ask, with that in mind, was there anything that the other poets here in the room said in their readings that stuck with you specifically, or surprised you, or if there are any feelings that you have after watching after taking in the other readings?
I was just so thrilled to hear Karla mention Angela Davis, because, you know, not that we took her for granted, but it was like, it was a thing of always, you know, hearing, and at that time it's like, this has to be done, this has to be done, this has to be done, and so it was done. And hearing the brief song, I'm not sure who wrote that, about, you know, who, you know, we're not afraid to die if it, you know, things need to get done. And she received death threats all the time, you know, many Panthers received death threats all the time and just continued. But to hear Karla, I enjoyed that piece that she did in her remembrance of being in contact with, you know, because then I mentioned Sonia Sanchez at the beginning of that poem, but I don't know if I just said Sister Sonia, because that's what we did. And it was good to hear that. It was good to hear that. And I'm sorry I'm late. I was at another event. I made it in, but thank you. Yeah, that's a takeaway for me, hearing Karla, because I've known Karla, I think, since she was in her teens. yeah, we've certain circles, you know, going way back, like, yeah. Yeah, her mom and I share a tree story. Yeah.
Thank you, Tureeda. Yeah, that tree poem. I was really taken by I love the question about how many guns they asked, how many guns as opposed to how much medicine. It's just like such a powerful refrain. And similarly, I was moved by Kim's naming what we know, which is the AIM, the AIM movement, getting lost. And then the two people you wrote about, Kim, I didn't know who they were, but I was so moved by your poems, and so thank you. And actually, Jennifer, I loved your panther metaphor. So I was moved by all the poets. I love that extended panther. I can't remember the exact line, but I remember how beautiful it was. So it was really beautiful to be with everybody.
Yeah. Will this be a recording that we can look at again? Because I missed. Okay, good. Thanks.
We do. And if anybody missed any of it, please feel free to send me an email, and I will drop my email here in the chat now, and we'll have a temp link up shortly. We do have a question from the audience, and I want to bring that in. It's from Pamela. Pamela is wondering, and I think this is for anyone who has an answer. How relevant is the Black Panthers 10-point program today? I think that's been touched on a little bit, but there's a follow-up, which is to the poets. What hit you the hardest when you thought about what the Black Panthers faced and what the Black community faces today?
Well, pretty much the same thing. Like I said in the poem, 23 years later, they ask how many guns, not what you're doing in the community. So it's still the focus, you know, what can we do in the community without you, you know, what Hoover said at the time, the biggest threat to America is the Panthers, because they were feeding children. They were pulling themselves up by the bootstraps. You know, it's like, it just, you know, so it was just a little, anyway, so we kept moving forward in knowing what had to be done. And even though there were these outside forces that just, you know, tried to say that, well, we, anyway, let me get back to the point. The point being, yes, it's still going on today. Many programs that you see, we started the lunch programs in the schools throughout the nation. We started that. That there was nothing like that. But yeah, here's the people that are supposedly, you know, the group that's supposedly the most dangerous group suddenly sets up a program that public education systems around the country are implementing. They're implementing that program. And so, housing, that's, well, we're looking at the streets right now, and I've had my students talk about that. Food, I'm really concerned about the food without labels that they're passing out. It has no label. We don't know what's in it, but kind of looks good. Anyway, I'll let others speak. I can go on and ramble. I'm a little emotional about this.
Thank you, Tureeda, rightly so. Thank you. Does anyone else wanna take that one?
Yeah, maybe. As a child, I remember the moment when the breakfast program started. I also have a vague memory of a truck that came around to test people's blood.
Yes.
And which was interesting for a number of reasons, but I distinctly remember that moment and the whole idea of medicine in the community as opposed to being separate, that healthcare be in the community as opposed to being utterly separate and above and over people was really remarkable and very moving. And we're going through all of these same things now. And I think one of the things that always makes me think of is the trick will be, and it's an important one, but working interculturally with everybody to try to get this really adjusted properly, because it's not, you know, it's a good idea that's gone really bad. I mean, all of the stuff on paper seemed very logical, and in practice, the whole thing has really come apart. So, not that it was ever really working, but anyway, that's my two cents.
Thank you, Kim. Anyone else before we do have another question? I don't want to move on too fast though. If I know that we're at the hour though, so I think I do want to ask this next one, which is from Mikell, who says, "I appreciate all the poetic insight and passion from all of you tonight. I would like to hear about the role or impact or presence of images in your expression in general, and how that relates to this project specifically."
Jennifer, did you, or anyone, I don't wanna be, talking all the time, okay. The images, I mean, if you experienced that time, then that expression and what Emory laid out, it evokes memory. It evokes that time. And I didn't see those folks specifically, but of course there were characters of every, on every realm speaking to this. So yeah, the details that you live through, you know, still talking about, you know, gun violence among police, you know, Fred Hampton Sr. getting killed while his wife was in the bedroom pregnant with their son. I mean, we had to, there's just certain things you live through, you know, just, there's just memories. So many memories. And that's why when the woman called from the Tribune, I didn't ask if the article was going to be published or anything. I do remember slamming the phone in her face after she asked how many guns did we have. I do remember that. And I just, what else could I say? Because we witnessed so much in the community. There was so much young people, the 12-year-old child that was strung out, her voice sounded like, I mean, there were just discussions we had about all kinds of, you know, illnesses and things that were going on that people didn't have to pay anything. They came into the clinic. We were volunteering. We had doctors. In fact, Dr. Small is one of the poets in the Patrice Lumumba anthology. And it was just, you see the picture and it pulls memory. It pulls memory. And I really can't thank Emory enough. I know he's been all over the world. He's a very, very kind, a very direct, just, you know, just there in his expression and anything that you have to ask, that he puts it in his paintings, in his cartoons. So I have a number of them here, including his book. Oh yeah. So yeah.
Thanks, Tureeda. Anyone else want to respond? Okay, thank you all. Thank you for the questions. Thank you, Mikell. This next one is from Rosa, and Rosa is wondering if someone would or could address the women's role in the Panther Party. How can we find parity among women and men in movements?
I'll jump in again because women, there were many women running the clinic. There was a guy, Smitty was head of the clinic, but the women that came there all the time, and then, you know, Sheba, who lives in Sacramento now, but, you know, there were people running the clinic. Judy Juanita was involved in, you know, a lot of the newspaper, the print, you know, because we had a newspaper. So all of that was going on. So women had a role. We demanded to be heard. Kathleen Cleaver, wow. And then just some of the, you know, the proud, strong female presence, you know, even when everyone was young. So it's like, it wasn't like we're gonna try and, you know, couldn't do everything, and young men were feeling themselves, feeling their power, moving, getting things done. We got some things done, wasn't perfect, but got a number of things done, and Black women were right there. Yeah, because they couldn't say anything to Angela, even and said, oh yeah. She said, I mean, in the way she would, you know, so you're telling us that we are violent, yet you have bombed our churches. That's like, how clear can that be? And yet she receives death threats. She would receive death threats. So, wow. It's astounding, astounding. And Ma and Megan, you know, you guys to pull this together, that's something. That's really what gave you the impetus to bring something like this together, if I may ask.
So needed. So needed, especially right now, always. And I love Emory's work. I'm always looking through Emory's books too for inspiration. And I loved how this piece especially speaks to, it's multi-generational. It just speaks to so many people and inspires so many people. And it's one of the works that gets a lot of attention from people who are on the alley. Always notice that when we give tours, people love the work. And it's always like, the youth are the ones who are always pointing out and are, you know, it's like, oh, that's Emory Douglas.
right.
So I love it. I love that it passes the message on and that it's a powerful in movement building and storytelling. Mm-hmm. So that was what it was for me, mm-hmm. this particular work.
Thank you, Megan. And did you want to add anything, Ma?
Well, I just wanted to add to what Megan's saying. When Megan had chosen the four works of four murals, and I was thinking about the poets who would, you know, go well as far as writing about the murals. It was just so wonderful because when I talked to Kim said, oh, I've already written all these poems about that mural. And Karla, like, you know, all four poets knew about the mural, had seen the mural, already had ideas about the mural. And I just feel like this project has been so organic that way, and that all the poets have just really been responsive to the works and just working together with everyone is just, you know, been wonderful. So just grateful to everyone.
Yeah, very much so. Very. And so David unfortunately could not technically get on. He's in the audience. Hi, David. But he was not able to sign in, and unfortunately Emory was not able to make it tonight. So that was unfortunate. But we miss you.
Thank you, guys. I have one more quick question. It's for you specifically, Tureeda. Someone is hoping that you might tell us what photo you're in front of, if you could tell us a little bit about that.
Oh, this is Yuri Guchiyama. She was the woman who tried to breathe life back into Malcolm right after he was shot. And Yuri has a family presence and she passed a few years ago, but she, wow, that woman, really, truly amazing. Always a fighter, an activist, I should say. Activist, a person that's there for all cultures, because we understood that all cultures are involved. There was no way to make that separation. She experienced what it was like dealing with the internment camps. There were things, you know, internment camps, slavery, you know. I mean, there's just, you could go on with the things that, we've gone through, but the need to keep Black people in a certain place, she was very much aware of. And so there were always events that she would be attending, the Malcolm X Festival, all of that. Just, yeah. You had something you wanted to say, Kim? Oh, okay.
Thanks, Tureeda.
Yeah.
And thank you all. I think maybe I'll turn it over to Megan and Maw if there's anything else that you guys would like to say. But first, I just want to thank you all so much for being here tonight and for joining us. I just want to say that this is the second of four events, and the next event, I'm gonna drop the link here in the chat shortly. But we have four more superheroes joining us for the next event. We have Celeste Chan, MK Chavez, Paul Coleman Roberts, and Tim Donnelly, who will be responding to the mural Affordable Housing, Vivienda Esquible, by the SF Poster Syndicate, working with the Western Regional Advocacy Project. And that is gonna be on April 30th. I hope that you all can join us for that event. And I'll drop the link over now, but Ma and Megan, if there's anything else you guys would like to say.
I just want to thank everyone again for joining us tonight, and to Jennifer and Kim and Tureeda and Karla for their wonderful, powerful words. And I am also so grateful to Evan for doing the sound and hosting, and thank you.
Yeah, and I want to say, I echo Ma. Thank you all so much. Deeply grateful and deep respect. I'm so bummed that David and Emory were not able to be here. Thank you all, though, for your powerful work. And thank you to Mahima for her tireless work on putting the video together. And Doug. Hi, Doug.
I just wanted to say thank you to Mom and Megan for being so sensitive during the whole COVID thing. Like the number of restarts and ways that you adjusted and adapted and were so responsive to all of our needs and to social distancing, and Mahima too, all the filming, and Evan. It was just, I mean, people in the audience, it was a lot to get this done. And Megan and Ma were like, warriors. Thank you so
much. Yes.
I'm afraid to unmute and say something. But thank you all, honestly, all of my fellow poets and everything. This is a joy of a project to participate in, and I'm really grateful.
I ditto everything everyone said. There's no more I can. I'm very, very thankful. And yes, thank you. Thank you for this invitation. And more to come. It's needed. It's needed. And who is Christopher?
Hey, Christopher. I was just going to actually ask if you had any parting words, Christopher.
Oh, no, I Tureeda, we met on the Zoom with Emory when we discussed the project, but I was introduced the whole evening before you were able to join when you were at your other event, because you're so in demand right now and always, because your work is so powerful. So, you know, I just wanted to say thank you to everybody for including me on such a special evening. And really appreciate all of your work. This is one of the most powerful events I've been a part of, because it has meant so deeply, has been part of my life for so long, and touched my life in so many ways, that it is really special to be able to be on this virtual stage with everybody. I'm just completely humbled and for a loss of words right now. So thank you all.
And thank you, everybody, for joining us.
Good night, everyone. Much love. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Mom, Megan, Karla, Kim, Jennifer, Christopher. Bye.